The year is 1574, Anno Domini. The people scurry around in panic. Soldiers mobilize and militiamen are mustered. The Tuchu pirate lord was sailing close with his 60 to 70 warships, a few thousand seasoned pirates, including the notorious Japanese Wako, and a heart full of ambition. This pirate lord, Limahong, was here to take Manila. Ahong, named Lim Hong or Lin Feng in Mandarin, was a Tuchu native whose origins aren't well known but had become a Wako lord. The Wako, or Wako in Japanese, were a multi-ethnic piracy phenomenon, often with Japanese warriors and Fujianese logistical and sailing expertise. They were often joined by Ryukyuans, Koreans, and others. Ahong grew strong enough that in 1573, he is said to have defeated Lim Dokien and absorbed a large part of his rival's forces. Lim Dokien, for his part, would flee to Cambodia and later become powerful in the Sultanate of Patani. Ahong was now the most powerful pirate in the Taiwan Strait region. In the previous decade, Ming generals like the famous Qi Ji Guang had been cracking down on the Wako piracy that had been devastating China's coastline. With the Ming dynasty finally taking maritime matters seriously again, staying in Hokkien, Fujian, would be difficult. As a result, Lim Ahong was forced to establish bases in the Penghu Islands, also known as the Pescadores, and on Taiwan in a place called Haikao in today's Yunlin County, where my ancestors called home, as well as Wanggang in today's Jiayi County. Yet Taiwan was not yet a source of wealth and was growing dangerous. The Plains Aborigines were launching a counteroffensive, and the Ming Navy was closing in on him by sea. Hence, Ahong looked southwards to the island Busong, or as we know it, Luzon. Today, the Philippines is one country, but then it was divided between many rajas, datus, and sultans. The Spanish and their Mexican auxiliaries had arrived, but their control over the islands was still young. Miguel Lopez de Legazpi, the great Spanish conqueror of today's Philippines, had established himself in Cebu in 1565, and by 1571 was conquering Tondo and Manila in Luzon, wresting the island from the grip of the Sultan of Brunei. Martin de Goiti, a half-Spaniard, half-Mexican captain, would lead the effort to subdue the local kingdoms and explore Pangasinan and Pampanga for Spain. He and his men were granted haciendas and lands, and he became intermarried into the local aristocracy. Legazpi would pass away in 1572, leaving Manila in the protection of Martin de Goiti. The young colony's strength was about to be tested. Lim Hong had every reason to have confidence in his military capabilities. He had the largest pirate force in the region and had a Japanese contingent, likely led by his lieutenant Shioko, possibly a Spanish rendering of Shoko. He had defeated a Spanish galleot near the modern-day Ilocos on his way to Manila, but a local conquistador, Juan de Salcedo, was able to warn the city. It was late November, 1574. Ahong is said to have landed 700 men wearing bamboo helmets, cotton corselets, and armed with arquebus, pikes, and blades. They hit Manila in the morning, destroying the forces of the Maestro de Campo, the veteran Martin de Goiti. He was killed in battle, but his resistance gave Manila time to mobilize. 14 Spaniards and an unknown number of auxiliaries were said to have killed 80 pirates. Though the veracity of the numbers is hard to confirm, the pirates did retreat. Juan de Salcedo arrived and reinforced the defenders, who now had built a palisade. They now had over 600 Mexican, Spanish, and Filipino soldiers and an unrecorded number of militiamen. Ahong attacked again, and while his pirates caused damage and managed to breach the walls, they were repulsed by the defenders once more. After losing a few hundred men and perhaps being low on provisions, not looking for such a tough battle, Lim Ahong left Manila and headed for Pangasinan. Ahong sailed up the Agnol River and rapidly controlled Pangasinan, building two palmwood forts and seizing nearby chiefs to extract provisions from the local villages. The Spaniards could not let this continue. Their rule was exploitative and hierarchical, yes, but also rested on military dominance and the protection of their subjects. Juan de Salcedo, the new Maestro de Campo, set out with 256 Spaniards, 2,500 native allies, all in 59 vessels, to fight Ahong. They arrived at the end of March and began blockading and besieging the pirate king. For 4 months, the pirates held off the Spaniards and Filipinos. Lim Hong had come to understand the dire straits he was in, but he wasn't the lord for no reason. He had another trick ready. During the siege, he had his men build 30 ships in his main fortress, and in August, they made their escape. He and his pirates fought their way through the Spanish-Filipino forces. According to legend, when they encountered the giant stakes driven into the riverbed to trap his ships, his men drew lots to decide who would dive and dismantle them. Many men drowned removing the stakes, but in the end, Ahong and most of his men escaped. Luzon would remain under Spanish colonial control, but the brave Juan de Salcedo would die in 1576 at the age of 27. Lim Ahong, perhaps with his prestige a bit hurt, continued as a pirate, and as late as 1589 he was collaborating with other pirate lords and raiding the Chinese coast. With such scarce documentation on this legendary pirate king, we don't know what became of him, but he was a pirate till passing out of the historical record. While some see a bloodthirsty bandit, I see a strategist. Looking at Lim Ahong's movements, he was considering the economics, the maritime trade routes, and the importance of what we now call the First Island Chain. Others like Li Dan, Pedro Chino, Zheng Zilong, and his son Zheng Chenggong would further refine the strategies of maritime dominance and militarism. Asia is known for land empires, yet the Tamils, Omanis, Malays, and southern Chinese armed merchants or pirate groups once dominated the sea lanes. This story is not only a Filipino one, but crosses into Fujian, Taiwan, and Japan, and played an important part in their histories. Today, the CCP-dominated People's Republic of China is flexing its muscles and contesting for control of the Asia-Pacific, as well as challenging the maritime dominance, security arrangement, and relatively liberal trade policies upheld by the United States of America. No matter where you lean politically, as you can see, it's important for us to understand what those generations of merchants, pirates, and aspiring sea lords knew. These straits, islands, the oceans, and the overseas links existing between the countries are every bit as vital as the states themselves. I hope you guys enjoyed that story about Lim Ahong and his attack on Luzon and the epicness of it all. It's too bad we don't know more about it. In any case, more to come. Thank you guys as always for following me on my journey. I salute yours. Peace.